In America, the social safety net is what we call the web of programs meant to help Americans in need.
A majority of Americans, something approaching 60%, depending on when you measure and how you measure, will experience poverty at some point in their lifetime.
But navigating the hurdles in this complex system means some go without these benefits.
I don't make enough to take care of all of my children and pay my bills. So that is stressful.
And as housing prices hit record highs, as do the number of homeless people, some Americans feel the pinch of shrinking federal housing assistance.
The hardest process is literally the finding process, because you're going through so many different landlords. So I'm up all night long trying to find somewhere to stay.
This is PBS News Weekly. I'm William Brangham. This week, we're focusing on America's social safety net programs. We begin with a look back at where they all began. NewsHour anchor Jeff Bennett with producer Sam Lane explain what America's public welfare system looks like, who it serves, and how it became what it is today.
The year was 1935. The U.S. was still struggling through the Great Depression. A quarter of the population was just unemployed, a level the country hadn't seen before and hasn't seen since. That August, as part of his New Deal, President Franklin Roosevelt signed the Social Security Act into law.
To safeguard the security of American workers and their families.
In addition to the retirement benefits it's now known for, the law laid a foundation for the government's role in programs like unemployment insurance and cash assistance for families. Roosevelt called it a cornerstone in a structure which is being built, but is by no means complete.
We have tried to frame a law which will give some measure of protection to the average citizen and to his family.
In the nearly 90 years since Roosevelt signed that law, politicians in Washington and in state houses across the country have argued about the best ways to help Americans who live in and near poverty. The disagreements have ranged from the dollar amounts of that assistance to how much it should be tied to work requirements, and even to how poverty itself is defined and measured. During his State of the Union in 1964, President Lyndon B. Johnson announced an unconditional war on poverty in America.
Our aim is not only to relieve the symptom of poverty, but to cure it, and above all, to prevent it.
Johnson's war included the creation of Medicare and Medicaid, a permanent food stamp program now known as SNAP, and the expansion of Social Security. At about the same time, the government came up with a uniform way to measure poverty by comparing a family's income against a national threshold. In 1959, the poverty rate sat at around 22%. By 1973, it had dropped to 11%, roughly where it was in 2022. With almost 40 million Americans in poverty. But the measure is widely considered imperfect. For example, some say the poverty line, about $31,000 for a family of four, is far too low. So there are other measures that account for things like geography, cost of living, consumption, or how much government assistance a family gets. No matter how it's measured, poverty is often misunderstood, says Cornell University professor Jamila Michener.
We tend to think about poverty as more niche and more limited than it actually is. And because of that, we can tell ourselves that people living in poverty are very, very different than people who aren't, that maybe there are some things wrong with them. A reality and something that people don't know is that if we take a life course perspective, a majority of Americans, something approaching 60%, depending on when you measure and how you measure, will experience poverty at some point in their lifetime.
Wow.
So most people, if
60%.
Or higher. It depends on how we measure it.
Is the social safety net then adequate in terms of meeting the need?
What I would say from my perspective as a research expert is a resounding no.
I would answer yes.
Matt Weidinger, a senior fellow at the Conservative American Enterprise Institute, has a different view. He helped create this chart of 80-plus programs from food aid to housing to health care that shows the complexity of the safety net. He says it can be difficult to track the success of specific programs, but...
If you look at nuanced poverty measures that count all the assistance the taxpayers provide, that count the resources that families themselves have from work, from relatives, owning their own homes and all that, the level of poverty in the United States had actually dropped to a relatively low level.
As a congressional staffer, Weidinger helped draft the landmark welfare reform law in the 1990s. The legislation followed years of anti-welfare sentiment driven by perceptions of rampant abuse. In his presidential campaigns, Ronald Reagan popularized the welfare queen stereotype of people cheating the system to collect benefits. By 1994, the number of Americans receiving cash assistance did reach its peak at 14 million. So in 1996, after a pledge to end welfare as we know it, President Clinton struck a deal with Republicans in Congress. It replaced the cash assistance program of the 1930s with temporary assistance for needy families. It imposed time limits and work requirements on welfare and made states responsible for distributing money. The number of families on welfare plummeted. In the years since those reforms, debates have continued over the size and shape of the social safety net.
I'm much more supportive of a work-based safety net, including because that's what the American people say they want. It's consistent with how people understand the American dream. They don't understand the American dream as being something where the government gives you a big enough check that you can avoid working. They understand the American dream as helping people go to work, lift their family, rise over time.
It's important to make the social safety net, I think, about what it is about, which is supporting people in times of need. And when we try to instead make it about making people work, it can end up not providing them with the support they need, ironically, with the support they need to work. Often we want to do that because there's some sort of principle. We just want to know that people aren't like mooching off the state or that they're working sufficiently hard.
And because the benefits are taxpayer funded.
Yeah, although to be fair, people who are living in and near poverty pay taxes too. If you think about it over the long course, many of us are paying in to the social safety net system, and many of us will draw out of that system in our time of need.
Before the pandemic, some 99 million Americans, 30% of the population, used at least one of the country's key safety net programs. Altogether, those programs cost the federal government well over $700 billion. And that doesn't include all of the money for things like the Affordable Care Act, which helps tens of millions of Americans access health care. When President Obama signed the ACA back in 2010, it represented the largest expansion of the safety net in decades. Still, despite welfare's reach, almost half of American households struggle to make ends meet, and the number is even higher among black and brown households.
Mama.
Over the coming weeks, we will bring you the stories of those families and show you what it's like to navigate America's increasingly complex social safety net. We explore why up to half the people eligible for benefits don't actually receive them.
It's very time consuming. They want to know every little penny, every little change in your circumstance. And any of that could affect you.
Why it's so hard to access housing assistance. How safety net benefits expanded dramatically during the pandemic and poverty plunged, only to rebound when the policies expired.
I felt like somebody started to feel our pain. And then they lost all of that. They forgot all that. And we were like hung to dry.
And what works and doesn't when it comes to alleviating food insecurity nationwide?
I was digging through my purse trying to find two pennies just to pay the rest of my SNAP.
I just feel like trash. That I'm here for a free handout. And I'm just nothing to this country.
In the debates around the costs of entitlements and benefits, the people who need assistance the most often get lost in the back and forth. Because of how hard it is to navigate the system, many people who qualify struggle to get and to keep their benefits. Economics correspondent Paul Solman and producer Diane Lincoln look at those challenges.
You want tea too?
Single mom Morgan Wingate is eligible for food stamps, but getting them?
You'll think that you did everything you were supposed to do. Then you come to find out that you're supposed to be doing something else.
Jessica Joyner's experience.
I submit my paperwork and it'll be 2 or 3 months had gone by where I get a response. Sometimes they don't get my information.
You really have to be on top of every piece of mail that comes in.
Lorianne Mills' food stamps were once cut off.
I didn't have my birth certificate or something. I didn't have access to it.
Georgetown University's Pamela Hurd co-authored the book Administrative Burden.
It can feel like a full-time job, both getting on those programs and then actually staying on them.
Orel Amram has seen the challenges in her work for Code for America.
You might have to
fill out a form that could take you over an hour to complete with questions that are potentially incomprehensible that can make you really nervous that you're answering incorrectly.
The results are stark. Literally billions in unclaimed benefits, says Amran.
There's $80 billion of money left on the table every single year because of how hard it is to navigate these hurdles.
Morgan Wingate's job has kept her from the in-person appointments required to maintain her WIC benefits, supplemental nutrition for women, infants, and children.
I just gave up. I just said, you know what, I'm not going to be able to make it because a lot of the appointments are during my work hours.
Yet Wingate, who works as a caregiver for people with disabilities, needs all the help she can get just to feed her kids.
I don't make enough to take care of all of my children and pay my bills. So that is stressful. I'll make you upset.
Lorianne Mills recently got a letter saying her Medicaid benefit was stopped because she did not recertify correctly.
I'm actually holding off on going to the doctor until I get it straightened out. That's my crisis. It takes that one little crisis.
Mills' finances were already precarious.
If it's not worrying about the quality of the food that you get just to make it to the end of the month, and the fact that even the cheap is so expensive now. You know, there's that, and then came up short on my rent. You know, what if they put a note on my door? You know, the stress of hearing that knock. The stress of how am I going to catch up?
The safety net's entanglements take a toll, says Pamela Hurd.
This is where it really hits people actually hard, I think. It's just the amount of stress, anxiety, and frustration people experience.
Janon Jones had her own struggles with getting benefits, but nothing like one of her friends.
She was in the shelter and she got kicked out. She has a child to provide for, so she had to do what she had to do.
What did she do?
She went into prostituting, because she couldn't get any assistance, and she did what she thought was right to provide for her and her son.
Nose?
No.
So why is it so hard for people?
It's about layers and layers of accumulated policy and regulations. We're very good at adding things and very bad at taking away regulations and requirements.
And government agencies are stretched thin.
Governments are seeing record numbers of cases continuing from the pandemic with also record staff vacancies.
But there are folks out there trying to make it easier.
This is the provider's app.
This app from Jimmy Chen's company Propel, based in Brooklyn, keeps track of your monthly food stamp use.
This is your transaction history as well as your deposit date.
Rather than call a 1-800 number to access the balance for your benefit card, called an EBT card, users can see their balance on the app for free.
Very similar to kind of how a bank might offer you a mobile app that lets you see your balance and transaction history, we did that same thing for the EBT card. And we currently serve more than 5 million households each month.
Of the 20 million American households with EBT cards, after stints at Facebook and LinkedIn, Chen launched Propel in 2014.
You've got companies like Uber and Airbnb, companies that are solving the problems faced by the demographic profiles of people who work in tech.
Relatively well-off people.
Relatively well-off people, yeah, solving their own problems. And the thing that made me uncomfortable was the feeling that in this day and age, low-income families also have access to smartphones and use the internet on a regular basis. And there are just way fewer software companies applying these state-of-the-art technology practices to solve their problems.
Now, Propel is a profit-making company, but Chen insists,
the way that we can build the scalable, sustainable impact that we're trying to build, not just a one-time summer project that helps people a little bit and then goes away, is by building a scalable business model behind it.
And that model includes job listings, a no-fee debit card, ads offering consumer discounts.
If you are purchasing online groceries through Walmart, they've given us this coupon code for our users to be able to get some money off their orders.
So this is one of the forms we're working to improve.
At nonprofit Code for America, Orel Amram is also trying to ease the process by simplifying government forms.
I believe this one is 16 pages.
Verification, you'll need copies of all of the following, all in capital letters, but copies of your official copy, oh my goodness. That's just the first page.
That's just the first page. And so already you're in this mindset of fear and stress before you've even started.
So how to make it user-friendly?
This is the form we helped Minnesota redesign. It used to take over 100 minutes on average.
Now it's mobile-friendly.
So we use things like the font size to draw your attention to certain areas,
right.
Just the information you need to know. So right. You know what sections you can skip, you can see where you're supposed to check a box. There's all sorts of visual cues.
And so for an application that used to take an average of 110 minutes to fill out,
we ultimately get to a form that takes 12 minutes on average, is available in multiple languages, is at a third grade reading level for the same 9 benefit program.
It's all an effort to reduce the burden on folks like Lorianne Mills.
We're here because we're down already. You know what I mean? Don't make it any more painful than it already is.
After all, the safety net eligible just want to get what's supposed to be theirs. For the PBS NewsHour, Paul Solomon.
While other social safety net programs expand, federal housing assistance has shrunk to its lowest level in almost 25 years. And sky-high homelessness and rental prices come as just 1 in 4 households who qualify for federal housing assistance actually receives that help. Stephanie Tsai and producer Mike Fritz investigate why.
25 a month.
Oh, that's real good.
Yeah.
In Mesquite, Texas, a suburb of Dallas, 36-year-old Cassalee Williams and her 2 children need to find a new place to live by the end of the month.
I like the outside.
Like the outside?
Mm-hmm.
But first, she and real estate agent LaTanya Donaldson have to find a landlord willing to accept the family's Housing Choice Voucher, also known as Section 8. Housing Choice Vouchers are the federal government's largest form of rental assistance. 2.3 million American households rely on the $30 billion program.
The hardest process is literally the finding process because you're going through so many different landlords. So I'm up all night long. All night long trying to find somewhere to stay.
Williams got on the program in 2010, 2 years after being hit by a pickup truck on the side of a Dallas highway.
I broke the first vertebrae in my neck. I broke my right shoulder. My hips were completely crushed, like literally in pieces. My pelvic was broken in 3 places.
So that led to disability?
Disability.
Lifelong?
Lifelong. There's a lot of cracks and stuff in the ceiling.
Williams considered herself lucky when she first found this house in Mesquite with her voucher.
I've been here 7 years. Love my landlord, love my house. But what has happened? My house has started to fall apart piece by piece. Literally every time it rains, the whole thing.
And does it flood your kitchen?
Yes, every single time.
Now she's back to square one, competing against other renters for a limited supply of houses in Dallas's more desirable suburban neighborhoods. Along the way, she says she's faced bias from landlords.
They automatically assume that you're going to, because you're on Section 8, that you're dirty or that you're almost not worthy of having a nice house because you need the help.
Moving is stressful for all of us. Moving with a Section 8 voucher is overwhelming.
Hello, this is Ann Lott.
Ann Lott runs the Inclusive Communities Project, a Texas nonprofit that helps people on housing choice vouchers. She hears stories like Cassalee Williams often.
As a matter of fact, in the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex, 93% of the landlords will not take a housing choice voucher.
A big reason for that, Lott says, is that in Texas, landlords can legally discriminate against prospective tenants who use voucher income for a portion of their rent.
From what I understand, Black families are disproportionately affected.
Approximately 85% of the families that we serve that have on the voucher program are African American. But unfortunately, what we found is that even with the voucher, the only areas that would accept Section 8 would be those high minority, high poverty areas.
You're speaking in past tense. Isn't that the case now?
That is still the case.
Thank you very much.
When President Nixon created the Section 8 program as an alternative to government-funded public housing developments, it allowed low-income Americans to take their rental assistance with them, giving them the opportunity to live outside of segregated neighborhoods.
So the idea that families wouldn't be tied to these units and could go, you know, purchase housing elsewhere, I think was an exciting prospect.
But 50 years later, the program hasn't lived up to its full promise, says Stephanie DeLuca, director of the Poverty and Inequality Research Lab at Johns Hopkins University.
Most voucher holders in the U.S. live in moderate to high poverty neighborhoods. And frankly, we've privatized public housing in the U.S., and that means that landlords are our housing providers. And the program rests on our ability to not only get their participation, but meet their needs as well.
Across the country, the number of vouchers is determined by annual funding from Congress. But studies have found that funding hasn't kept up with rental prices. Another problem is housing supply, says Kevin Corinth with the Conservative American Enterprise Institute.
If we can only build, and build some more, that's the only way we have a potential chance of getting families access to these high opportunity areas that have been demonstrated to have major successful outcomes for themselves and for their kids.
A lack of affordable housing has led to a surge in homelessness in cities like San Francisco, Los Angeles, and New York. But here in Seattle, one of the nation's least affordable cities, there's a renewed focus on housing vouchers and how to make the system work better for applicants and landlords.
This is one of our studio apartments. It's about 250 square feet.
Ben Moritz is a landlord who owns about 900 affordable apartment units in the city.
We've built a lot of housing, especially the kind of basic low frills housing like what you're seeing here, that is a very good fit for the voucher program.
Unlike in Dallas, landlords here cannot deny applicants on the basis of their income source. And Moritz says the Seattle Housing Authority makes it easy to rent to tenants with vouchers.
The downside and the risks aren't that much. And frankly, our business does better when we have those kinds of stable rent payments that come from a voucher resident. They're very easy to work with, they pay on time, they pay electronically, and they have a pretty good case management and dispute resolution system.
Tysonia McLean with the Seattle Housing Authority says the city tries to address landlords' concerns.
If a tenant falls behind on rent, they can submit a referral and get assistance with that rent amount. If the tenant decides to move out and leaves a high utility bill, they can get assistance with that. If something were to happen and the unit was left damaged, they can receive funds up to $5,000 to repair those damages.
There's a total of three people in the household, correct?
Yes.
They also lend a hand to prospective tenants. McLean leads a team of housing counselors who help connect individuals with potential resources, like help with paying for moving costs, security deposits, and application fees.
Of course, the main way you can always, you know, apply is through our online applications process.
Since January, the Housing Authority has been holding public information sessions for people hoping to get on the waiting list for a housing choice voucher. It's been 7 years since Seattle opened that list to applicants.
We get calls every day through our referral line about housing. I'm sleeping in my car, I'm sleeping in Tent City, I'm sleeping on someone's couch.
Seattle is hoping to distribute 800 housing choice vouchers by the end of the year, but already 14,000 people have applied. Whether an individual or family gets one is based largely on luck, says Kevin Corinth, who believes the program should be redesigned.
It's essentially a lottery. Those who are very lucky will get assistance. Everyone else gets nothing. Another problem is that it discourages families from earning more. Basically, your rent effectively goes up if you earn more money, which can discourage upward mobility.
So what are you going to get?
A maple bar.
But for those who receive one, like 42-year-old Sarah Richardson, a housing choice voucher can be life-changing.
I don't know where we would be today without the voucher.
She got one from the Seattle Housing Authority in 2017. Growing up, Richardson says she battled homelessness and later drug addiction and incarceration. Having a permanent home helped her turn her life around.
So when I got the news that my number came up on the wait list, I cried, I screamed, I was so excited because I knew that finally I was gonna feel stable.
stability, and also opportunities for her 11-year-old daughter, Jabria, that she didn't have. Their voucher afforded them a house in one of Seattle's better neighborhoods. Her 21-year-old goddaughter, Aaliyah, also lives in the home. Seattle's commitment to making the process easier was crucial.
What's next? What are your greatest hopes for the future?
Getting my daughter through middle school and high school, and that's like what my goal is to push and help and be the best mom that I can be.
Hey, girl!
Back in Texas, Cassalee Williams has the same simple dream. But when we left them, they were still sending out applications to landlords.
How optimistic are you feeling about this?
Honestly, I'm trying to be as positive as I possibly can, even though it's terrifying. And it's terrifying because you just don't know.
Last week, after 2.5 months of searching, the Williams family finally found a rental and a landlord who will accept their voucher. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Stephanie Tsai.
That's it for this episode of PBS News Weekly. For more of our coverage of America's social safety net, check out the rest of the series, including a report by Amna Nawaz and producer Sam Lane on the federal child tax credit, a two-part look at the state of Medicaid in America from John Yang with producers Sam Weber and Keisha Young, and a story on the persistent problem of food insecurity by Laura Barone-Lopez and producer Maya Linnae Bura. For all of us, thank you so much for watching.